what about the Satchel Pages of the future? Will they be playing in the big leagues? The question becomes more pressing yearly. It has been tossed into old Judge Landis's lap more than once in the spectacularly adroit manner in which this articulate apostle of Lincoln tosses it out the window is a source of much marvel. Joe Williams, New York World Telegram.
There is no rule, formal or informal, or any understanding, unwritten, subterranean, or sub-anything, against the hiring of Negro players by the teams of organized ball. Kennesaw Mountain Landis.
He had helped restore the game's integrity after the Black Sox scandal of 1919. He had also done all he could to keep it white. It was true that there had never been any written law banning black players, but Judge Landis had worked ceaselessly to ensure that the old gentleman's agreement against hiring them remained firmly in effect. When the Pittsburgh Pirates sought permission to hire slugger Josh Gibson in 1943, Landis bluntly refused. The colored ball players have their own league. Let them stay in their own league. When Bill Veeck Jr. attempted to buy the eighth place Phillies, then restaff it with stars from the Negro Leagues, Landis made sure the team was sold to someone else. And when Leo DeRocher told a newspaper man that he'd seen plenty of blacks good enough for the big leagues, Landis forced him to claim he had been misquoted. But the hypocrisy of fighting racism abroad while ignoring it at home grew clearer. Pickets appeared at Yankee Stadium with signs reading, "If we are able to stop bullets, why not balls?"
This war dealt with racism in part. And this was brought home. So I think there was this heightened consciousness about racism itself and the whole war discrediting racism. And I think that was what energized black people to a great degree.
Blacks now demanded and got thousands of good-paying defense jobs. And with their newfound economic strength, they supported the Negro Leagues as never before, and they insisted on equal opportunity. Black leaders again pressed Landis for an answer.
"I've said everything that's going to be said on that subject. The answer is no."
On July 6, 1944, a month after D-Day, a young Army lieutenant named Jack Roosevelt Robinson boarded a military bus near Fort Hood, Texas. The driver ordered him to get to the back of the bus where the colored people belong. Robinson refused and was court-martialed. But the Army judges found him fully within his rights and acquitted him. "I had learned," Robinson wrote, "that I was in two wars, one against a foreign enemy, the other against prejudice at home." A few days after Robinson's trial, Kennesaw Mountain Landis died at the age of 77.
"Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the park. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I don't care if I ever get back. You can root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. When it's 1-2, three strike you out at the old ball game." There you are.
We're gonna win that ball game, Uncle Sam. So pitch that cannonball the way you can. You are slow beginning, but just wait till that ninth inning. You can finish what they all began. We're gonna win that ball game, Uncle Sam. Show the Axis how we play in the good old U.S. way. You're gonna win that ball game, Uncle Sam.
When the war ended in August 1945, General Douglas MacArthur assumed command of the American occupation of Japan. He found the stadium in which the Tokyo Giants had played before the war filled with unexploded ammunition. He ordered it cleared and urged that the Japanese start playing baseball again. It would foster democracy, he said.
Baseball people are generally allergic to new ideas. It took years to persuade them to put numbers on uniforms. It is the hardest thing in the world to get big league baseball to change anything, even spikes on a new pair of shoes. But they will, eventually. They are bound to. Branch Rickey.
This I know. In March of 1945, Mr. Rickey told me in confidence that only the board of directors of the ball club knew, and only his family knew, and now I was going to know, that he was going to bring a black player to the white Dodgers. And Mr. Rickey said that going back to when he was the baseball coach at Ohio Wesleyan University, he took the team down to play a series at South Bend, Indiana with Notre Dame. And he said, my best player was my catcher, and he was black. But, said Mr. Rickey, when we were registering the squad in the hotel, when the black player stepped up to sign the register, the clerk jerked the register back and said, we don't register niggers in this hotel. And Rickey said, I remonstrated and said, this is the baseball team from Ohio West End. We're the guests of Notre Dame University. He said, I don't care who you are. We don't register niggers in this hotel. Well, Mr. Rickey said, there are two beds in my room, aren't they? And he says, well, says, can't he use one bed and not register? And the clerk grudgingly allowed that to happen. And Mr. Rickey took the key, handed it to the black player, and said, you go up to the room and wait for me. As soon as I get the rest of the team settled, I'll be up. Mr. Rickey said, when I opened the door, here this fine young man was sitting on the edge of a chair, and he was crying, and he was pulling at his hands. And he said, Mr. Rickey, it's my skin. If I could just tear it off, I'd be like everyone else. And Mr. Rickey told me this day in March of 1945, he said, all these years I have heard that boy crying. And now he said, I'm going to do something about it.
This is a particularly good year to campaign against the evils of bigotry, prejudice, and race hatred. Because we have witnessed the defeat of enemies who tried to found a mastery of the world upon such cruel and fallacious policy. New York Times.
Judge Landis's replacement as commissioner was a jovial, gregarious senator from Kentucky, Albert Benjamin Happy Chandler, who said he took the job because the $50,000 salary was so much more than the $10,000 he'd been making as United States Senator. Few thought he would be an improvement. But in April 1945, two black sports writers, Wendell Smith and Rick Roberts, who had campaigned tirelessly for integration since before the war, called upon the new commissioner to find out where he stood. If a black boy can make it on Okinawa and Guadalcanal, Chandler told his visitors, hell, he can make it in baseball. Still, a secret vote revealed that 15 out of 16 club owners opposed integration. The lone exception was Branch Rickey, who had left St. Louis in 1942 to become president and general manager for the Brooklyn Dodgers.
It was in a narrow, tight, and unenlightened world. It was Branch Rickey who said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to integrate baseball. I'm no longer going to allow a part of the population to be excluded. Now, Rickey's detractors say he would do anything to win. And it wasn't because he had such a big heart or that he was such a great believer in civil rights. He simply wanted to win. Well, there were a lot of men in baseball who wanted to win, and they wouldn't go this far. This is far? I don't think so at all.
Branch Rickey was equally celebrated for his shrewdness and for the sermons he loved to deliver for the sports pages. Red Smith said he was a man of many facets, all turned on. Reporters called his office the Cave of the Winds and called him the Deacon and the Mahatma because he reminded them of a combination of God, your father, and a Tammany Hall leader.
Branch Rickey is a con man. Brilliant, fascinating, erudite, but still a con man. I've been listening to him for 25 years. I've always been impressed, seldom enlightened. The trick of the con man is to weave a spell. In this, Branch Rickey stands alone. Not since the days of William Jennings Bryan and Billy Sunday has any man fallen so deeply in love with the melodic quality of his own voice. Joe Williams, New York World Telegram.
He pitches, and the hitter swings at the slow bounder down.
Rickey had already transformed the game once by devising the farm system during his quarter of a century as president of the St. Louis Cardinals. He was already rich and in his 60s. But he loved the challenge of building a new dynasty, and he loved Brooklyn, its fierce local loyalties, its distinctive neighborhoods, and devotion to the Dodgers. Now he was plotting a second, still more sweeping revolution. Rickey believed with equal fervor in fair play and big profits. He was convinced integration would be good for America, for baseball, and for his balance sheet.
Branch Rickey had seen us play before 50,000 people in Comiskey Park. You understand? We had played in Yankee Stadium, you know, with 30,000 and 40,000 people. And we played at the Dodger at Ebbets Field. So he knew here's a new source of revenue.
The greatest untapped reservoir of raw material in the history of the game is the black race, Rickey confided. The Negroes will make us winners for years to come. His broadcaster, Red Barber, was stunned and contemplated resigning.
But Mr. Rickey told me that he was going to bring a black player to the Brooklyn Dodgers. I didn't doubt him. You didn't doubt Mr. Rickey. He said he was going to do it. He was going to do it. Well, I came home and talked to my wife, Lila, and I said, after all, you have to remember, I was born in Columbus, Mississippi. I grew up in Sanford, Florida. I went to a segregated university, University of Florida. This was something I never even dreamed of, and it was a shock to me. I think it is only honest to say so.
Meanwhile, Branch Rickey's scouts began to scour the Negro Leagues for a likely player.
A race man is a person who is proud of his race. He wants his race to advance. He wants his race to be recognized. That's the type of guy Jackie was. That's his whole thing, recognition. Treat me as I'm supposed to be treated. Give our people a fair shot at it. We make it fine, if we don't make it, that's still fine. But give us an equal chance. That's what a race man is.
Jack Roosevelt Robinson was born in 1919 in Cairo, Georgia, the grandson of a slave and the fifth child of a sharecropper who soon deserted his family. He was brought up by his mother, a domestic, in a white neighborhood in Pasadena, California, where white children pelted him with rocks until he and his elder brothers began to pelt them back.
Jack, even in high school, was concerned about what was happening to his race. He had that early on. His mother, Mally Robinson, was an extraordinary woman. And she came up from Georgia with five children and no prospects, and just her determination to make it for her kids, that she set the example and set the pace. She was a real pioneer. And so a part of what she gave him was self-esteem. He wore white shirts to UCLA. He was ebony black. And at a time when my generation really was not that proud to be black, but not Jack. And what attracted me to him was he walked straight, he held his head up, and he was proud of not just his color, but his people.
At Pasadena Junior College in UCLA, he excelled at every sport he tried, led his basketball league in scoring 2 years running, broke his own brother's national record at the broad jump, and was one of the country's best running backs in football.
Watch him leading UCLA to a 16-6 victory over Oregon on October 28, 1939. Touchdown for Jackie Robinson.
Baseball was relatively low on his list, but he was good enough at it so that when he left the Army in 1944, the Kansas City Monarchs offered him a job as shortstop at $400 a month.
Jackie came to Kansas City Monarchs in 1945. We spring trained that year in Houston, Texas. And after spring training, we went to New Orleans, exhibition game there. Well, we had more people in the seats in the bus. Jack said, look, I'm a rookie. My seat is in the step of the bus. I'm gonna earn mine just like everybody else. That's the type of guy that he was.
Jackie came to the Monarchs, and we had been going for 30 years going to this filling station in Oklahoma. And where we would buy the gas, we got 250-gallon tanks on that thing. We'd buy the gas, but we couldn't use the restroom. Jackie wanted to use the restroom. Jackie said, I'm going to the restroom. Man, I said, boy, you can't go to that restroom. Jackie said, take the hose out the tank. Take the hose out the tank. This guy gonna sell 100 gallons of gas. He ain't gonna sell 100 gallons of gas in another month. See? So he said, well, and I'll tell you what. Jackie said, we can't go to the restroom, we won't get any gas here. We get it someplace else. He said, well, you boys can go to the restroom, but don't stay long. So actually, he started something there. Now, every place we would go, we wanted to know first, could we use the restroom? If we couldn't use the restroom, no gas.
He hit 387 his first season, and Wendell Smith, still pressing for integration, arranged a tryout for Robinson and two other young Negro League players with the Boston Red Sox. Although Boston manager Joe Cronin was impressed by Robinson's skills, Boston passed up the opportunity to become the first major league team to integrate. Instead, it would be the last. By this time, Robinson had caught the attention of Branch Rickey. He sent his chief scout, Clyde Sukeforth, to look Robinson over.
Well, he called me and he said, I want you to see a game in Chicago Friday night. He said, paying particular attention to a fellow named Robinson. Now, he said, I want you to identify yourself. Tell him who sent you and what you want to see, his arm, paying particular attention to his arm.
Sukeforth was impressed and told Robinson Branch Rickey would like to see him.
He came down and I talked to him at length. I mean, he was pouring the questions to me about why is Ricky interested in me? And the more you talk to the guy, the more you're impressed with the guy. The determination written all over him.
Robinson did not know precisely what Ricky had in mind, but he agreed to accompany Sukeforth back to Brooklyn.
Well, I introduced Robinson, and Mr. Ricky went right to work on him. He said, Jack, I've been looking for a great colored ball player for a great many years. I have some reason to believe you might be that man.
Mr. Ricky, who had never laid eyes on Robinson, sent for him and had him in his office for 3 hours. Mr. Ricky was not only very intelligent, but very intelligent vocally. He never used profanity, and his strongest expletive was Judas Priest. But that morning, Mr. Ricky took Robinson into every possible negative situation he would encounter. In all of the world of Jim Crowism, etc. And he took Robinson into what would happen on the playing field, that he'd be thrown at his head, that he would be slid into and spiked, etc. He screamed in his face every expletive that Robinson would ever hear. And he said to Robinson, do you have the guts not to fight back? And he said, finally, the only way you can be the first man to do this, the first black man, is you'll have to promise me that for 3 years, you will not answer back. You cannot win this by a retaliation. You can't echo a curse with a curse, a blow with a blow.
So Robinson gave it a little thought before he answered. And that impressed Ricky. If he'd have said right off quick, oh, I can do that. Well, he gave it some thought and he said, Mr. Ricky, if you want to take this gamble, I'll promise you there'll be no incident. And that was just what Ricky wanted to hear.
He picked Jack because he showed an assertive side of himself, which he would need. He showed the kind of strength to go through things. He also was a deeply religious man, Mr. Ricky was, and he knew about Jack's religious convictions. So they were kind of alike in that sense. I think he saw the various aspects of the character that attracted him and made him feel that he could come through a scathing experience without being harmed or without giving in, giving up. There was very much of a partnership between them, and they had to agree on these things because they were in it together. Ricky needed Jack as much as Jack needed Ricky. They just had to do it together.
They picked him because of who he was and what he was. Sure, the baseball skill was important, but there were other skilled players. Monty Irvin, everyone expected would be the first. But Robinson had a determination and an ability to, on the one hand, turn the other cheek, but on the other hand, that as he turned the cheek, to let the person who was his antagonist know that it would come around again.
The one thing that we weren't sure of, that Jacker could hold his temper. Jacker had a terrific temper. He knew how to fight and he would fight. If Jacker could hold down that temper, he can do it. He knew he had the whole black race, so to speak, on his shoulders. So he just said, well, I can take it, I can handle it. I will take it for the rest of the country and the guys. And that's why he took all that mess. And it killed him.
On Tuesday, October 23rd, 1945, Ricky's office made an announcement that it said would affect baseball from coast to coast. The Montreal Royals, the Dodgers' top farm club, had hired Jackie Robinson. If he did well for Montreal, he would move up to the Dodgers.
I saw baseball after the Black Sox scandal. Everybody said, well, baseball, it kind of got off of baseball. See, and here come Babe Ruth hitting the home run. That brought it back. See, then we went into another little recession in baseball. Here come the lights. That brought it back. See, now we go into the wall, and all the good ball players gone. So that kind of brought it down a little. Here come Jackie Robinson.
Through most of the 1946 season, the baseball world's attention was riveted on the Montreal Royals and Jackie Robinson. Branch Rickey hoped Robinson would have an easier time in Canada, where race was much less of an issue. But the Montreal Royals manager was Clay Hopper, a Mississippian. He begged Rickey not to make him the manager of an integrated team, asking, do you really think a nigger's a human being? Robinson later confessed that he'd been nervous as the devil, but he told reporters he was ready for any challenge he might meet from white fans or white players. I'm ready to take the chance. Maybe I'm doing something for my race. Rogers Hornsby, the great National League slugger, said an integrated team would never work. Bob Feller, who had often barnstormed with black teams, was sure Robinson would fall short. He was too muscle-bound to hit well, he explained. If he were a white man, I doubt they would even consider him big league material. But in his very first game for Montreal, at Jersey City on April 18th, Robinson went 4 for 5, stole 2 bases, and scored twice by provoking the pitcher to balk. This would have been a big day for any man, the New York Times reported, but under the special circumstances, it was a tremendous feat. On the road, Robinson endured without complaint separate and unequal facilities, pretended not to hear the taunts of his opponents, nor to mind the initial coolness of his teammates. The pressure and the abuse were unrelenting.
It came in all the forms that racism comes in. It came in the form of racial epithets, it came in the form of gestures. It came in the form of little incidents like putting the black cat on the field. I was sitting in a section where there were some rabid anti-Robinson people who were yelling at him, calling him names. It was really to try to throw him off. They wanted him to hear them. As a matter of fact, I felt it so keenly. They were at my back, and I could not turn around because I was under the same constraints Jack was under. But I kept hoping that my body was blocking some of the sound, you know, that because I could see what their intent was.
As the season progressed, he was racked by stomach pain, on the brink of a nervous breakdown. But in the face of all the abuse, Robinson only played better. Robinson sparked the Royals with sharp hitting and fielding, daring base running, leading them first to the league championship and then to victory in the minor league World Series. After the final game, jubilant Montreal fans chased Robinson for 3 blocks as he left the stadium. It was probably the only day in history, a friend remembered, that a black man ran from a white mob with love instead of lynching on its mind. Even Clay Hopper, the Montreal manager who had questioned Robinson's humanity before the season started, now called him a great ball player. and he urged Branch Rickey to move him up to the Dodgers for the 1947 season. But Rickey gave no indication of his intentions.
February 1st, 1947. I know the real reason Josh Gibson died. I don't need a doctor's report for confirmation either. He was murdered by Big League Baseball. Pittsburgh Courier.
Josh Gibson, perhaps the greatest of all the Negro League stars, was just 35 in the winter of 1947. But old beyond his years. He had lost weight, was drinking too much, no longer able to play as he once had because of constant pain in his knees. And he had grown increasingly erratic, lapsing into long silences, hearing voices no one else could hear, threatening suicide, holding imaginary conversations in which he tried in vain to persuade Joe DiMaggio to recognize him. On January 20th, he suffered a stroke and died. There was no money for a gravestone.
You're in a neighborhood that you've never been in before. You understand that feeling that you would have? All right, here's Jackie. And the jacket to play in the major leagues, that meant one white boy wasn't gonna play. See? And so this is, I could understand the rebellion. I could understand the rebellion because we had played against these fellas. And they knew that we could play. And they knew if we were allowed to play, a lot of them wouldn't play.
During spring training 1947, Rickey staged a seven-game series between the Dodgers and the Royals in order to display Jackie Robinson's skills to the men with whom he hoped Robinson would soon be playing. The strategy backfired. Robinson's brilliant play, he batted .625 and stole seven bases, seemed only to antagonize his future teammates. Nearly half of the Dodgers were Southern whites, and three of their players, outfielder Dixie Walker, second baseman Eddie Stanky, and the third string catcher Bobby Bragan, all from Alabama, drew up a petition saying they would rather be traded than play with a black teammate, then went around gathering signatures.
DeRocher heard about that petition. And he called a meeting, and he really laid down the law. He said, in effect, you know what you can do with that petition. And also, when Mr. Rickey gets here tomorrow, if some of you fellows don't want to play with him, Mr. Rickey will take care of it, because he's coming. He can play ball. And more than that, there are more black players coming after him, and you fellows had better shape up.
One Southerner refused to sign. Shortstop Pee-wee Reese from Louisville, Kentucky.
Pee-wee Reese was one of the first to give a public reaction. He was being mustered out of the armed forces. And he got the word that Robinson was coming. And Robinson had been playing shortstop. And some writer asked Pee-wee how he felt about it. And Pee-wee said, well, if he can take my job, he's entitled to it.
The players' revolt was stopped before it got started. Jackie Robinson was going to make them all rich, DeRocher assured the Dodgers. He had made the team and would be with them when they started the season at Ebbets Field.
Happy, happy. We've been looking forward to this thing for years. Everybody was so happy now. Here, Jack is going to the major leagues. We were all elated. But it was a death knell for our baseball. But who cared? Who cared?
Hudgens has 1-3. Outfield, Antwood left. 21 pitch. Swung on as a high fly ball deep to the left field. Way back to the left field. It is in there for a home run, and it's a 10-6 ball game.
Scoring became almost an obsession with me when I was a child, because my father taught me so proudly how to master all those miniature symbols, and then left me when the radio was on to score the games while he went to work. And when he would come home when I was 5 or 6 years old, he would ask me to go through from inning to inning, and I would recreate the entire game for him. And he never let me know that in the newspapers the next day, he could have found out from the newspapers what had happened. I thought without me, he wouldn't know what had happened in the game. And so I was really like a little historian in those days. And it was such a magic thing. When he would come home, I would sit on the porch with him, go over my meticulously kept game, and feel like I was saving it for him forever.
Reese swings and misses.
In 1901, Michael Francis Aloysius Kearns was born in Brooklyn, the son of a fireman. His younger brother was killed by a trolley car. His mother and father died shortly thereafter. And he was raised by an aunt in Flatbush, in the shadow of Ebbets Field. He became a bank examiner for the state of New York, moved to Long Island, but remained a devoted Dodger fan. In 1943, his daughter Doris was born.
I think my earliest memory is being taken when I was maybe 4 years old to Brooklyn. So my memory of the Dodgers is connected to my father showing me the street where he grew up, where he played ball, taking me to Horn and Hard Arts cafeteria and sticking the nickels in, all of which was just as important to me at that time as going to Ebbets Field. But as we approached Ebbets Field, he made it seem like a shrine. I don't really remember the game, but just the whole fabric of being there with him and knowing it was so special that he was sharing his past with me that day. One of the things baseball allowed him and me to do is at night when he put me to bed, he would tell me stories of the past. So I would hear all of his favorite memories going back to 1910. And he described to me the importance of Jackie Robinson being there for civil rights. But more importantly, he told me, this guy's a great player, and we're going to win with him. So it was all connected in a very little girl's mind with somebody who then became my hero from the time I was 4 until he stopped playing baseball.
History was made here Tuesday afternoon in Brooklyn's flag-bedecked Ebbets Field when smiling Jackie Robinson trotted out on the green-swept diamond with the rest of his Dodger teammates. No less than 15 photographers surrounded Robinson before the game and clicked his picture from every position imaginable. Pittsburgh Courier.
On April 15th, 1947, at Ebbets Field in Flatbush, in the borough of Brooklyn in New York City, the Brooklyn Dodgers faced the Boston Braves. It was opening day, and for the first time in modern Major League history, a black man, Jack Roosevelt Robinson, was starting the game at first base. There were 26,623 fans in the stands, more than half of them black, come to see Jackie Robinson. Although Robinson went hitless in 3 trips to the plate, just the sight of him stirred the crowd.
I remember the excitement and just the feeling of having gotten through it and a sense that Ebbets Field itself was small enough so that we kind of felt immediately that we could find our place in it. At least I did. The black fans were so tense and so enthusiastic and so their expectations were so high and their aspirations were so high that they just reacted to everything. Every swing of the bat, somehow they got something going with the black fans. And white fans, I think, were probably more in a frame of mind to wait and see. There was this overpowering feeling that people's hopes were riding on what Jack was doing as much as their interest as fans in the score.
The Dodgers won that day, 5-3.
You can almost divide American history in the 20th century before Robinson and after Robinson. America was defined by baseball. This was our national game. So the drama of this moment of Robinson coming in is enormous because of the game being tied to the national character. In some way, the game being tied with America's sense of its mission and its destiny.
For me, baseball's finest moment is the day Jackie Robinson set foot on a major league field for the first time in 1947. I'm most proud to be an American, most proud to be a baseball fan. When baseball has led America rather than followed it. It has done so several times, but this is the most transforming incident. I can think of no man having a more difficult road ahead of him than Jackie Robinson did in 47, and no one walking that road more valiantly or more proficiently. I would say that Jackie Robinson is my great hero among baseball players, and he's my great hero as an American. He is an individual who shaped the crowd.
Elsewhere in Brooklyn that evening, at 1574 50th Street in Borough Park, a Jewish family gathered for Seder, the Feast of Passover. Why is this night different from all other nights? The youngest male asked in the centuries-old tradition. Before his father could reply, he answered his own question. Because a black man is playing in the major leagues.
Too late. It was a wonderful moment when it happened, but when I think of it, you know, what it brings pain too. It was a great triumph, and Branch Rickey was a great, great leader in this society. But why? Why did it take all those years? Why should it have been such a big event? Why weren't we capable of better? How could you possibly say that they were less than we were? Didn't we put that behind us in the Civil War? Why wasn't the question settled?
The appeal of baseball was that it was fair, that if you understood the rules, all you had to do was work hard and reach the maximum level of your ability, and you could succeed. This was the promise that anyone could be an American, anyone could play baseball. It wasn't really true. Jackie Robinson made it true.
The Iron Curtain, which has prevented Negroes from participation in Major League Baseball, has finally been lifted. Now, the real challenge faces Negro America. the challenge of taking this tremendous victory in stride. The challenge to stop our booing over some untoward incident which might happen on the ball field. Remember that Jackie might be roughed up some. Remember, today, Negro America, whose symbol is Jackie Robinson, is on trial. Mr. Ricky opened the door, and Jackie's foot is in it. Pittsburgh Courier.
Make no mistake about it, Jackie could have been a Brazilian anything. If Jackie hadn't started drawing people to that park and been able to produce, he'd have been gone. And that, I think that's one reason he fought so hard, because he knew if he failed, then our people would fail. And he was determined to make it.
And he was the most exciting ball player that we had, and the greatest gate attraction since Babe Ruth. The thing that made Robinson so exciting was his base running. When Robinson was on base, dashing off first base, dashing off second, dashing off third, threatening to steal the next base, upsetting the pitcher, every eye in the ballpark was on Jackie Robinson.
Robinson played brilliantly and drew just the kind of huge crowds that Branch Rickey had hoped for. By July, the Dodgers were in first place.
One ball, one strike, one out, one run. Jackie at the bat. Here's what he done. He hit the ball with the bat. The bat hit the ball. You should have heard those fans on the ball. Good, it's gone. This time it's really gone. They do the baseball boogie when Jackie comes running home. Now the umpire hollers the same old thing. Grabs Jackie's bat and begins to swing. Camera starts to flash, joins the crowd. Bat in my hands and holler me loud. Good, it's gone. This time it's really gone. They do the baseball boogie when Jackie comes running home. Says she was old to go. She listened in on the radio. Her feet got happy. She grabbed the dress. First thing she hollered, Jackie Robinson is a mess. Going, it's going. This time it's really gone. She done the baseball boogie when Jackie comes running home.
He ran up those base paths and just excited the crowd. I mean, he began to pull people on his side by his performance. And his performance also was his outlet. So it worked both ways, that he created fans immediately. I mean, the electricity was in the air in the stands, on the field, and in our hearts.
Well, the thing about Jackie Robinson that was so thrilling to me was that every time he got on base, you just felt like everybody else was nervous. So you felt like he was controlling the whole tempo of the game, and you knew he was going to steal second at some point, or you knew he would pretend to steal second at some point, and that the pitcher was nervous and he wasn't making as good of a pitch. And somehow all eyes were riveted toward him, so that when they were on the base path, you just somehow felt something was going to happen, some magic. It didn't always happen, but you felt it always could. So there was that sense of electricity. And I just thought he was the best there was.
Shea pitching to Jackie Robinson in the first inning, walks the Brooklyn first baseman, and the Dodgers have a rally in the making with Pete Reiser coming to bat. And then Robinson promptly steals second base.
What happened is Jackie took black baseball to the major leagues. See, at the time, baseball was a base-to-base thing You hit the ball, you wait on first base till somebody hit it again. See? But in our baseball, you got on base. If you walked, you stole second, you try to steal, they bunch you over to third, and you actually scored runs without a hit. This was our baseball.
I saw him once, he walked. Face on balls, got to first base, and he walked down to first base, didn't try. Got to first base, just turned around with his foot on the base, didn't move. The pitcher looked over at him. Robinson didn't even move off the base. Pitcher started to throw, Robinson stole second. Got in the second base, now the pitcher's looking back like this, looking back. Robinson was taking a lead now. The pitcher kept looking back. He walked the batter. Men in first and second. Robinson still moving back and forth, back and forth. He walked the next batter. Now Robinson's in third base, base is loaded, and he took this tremendous lead. He just walked off the base, 10, 15, 20 feet, and the pitcher was almost panicky. The third baseman came in, he threw over, Robinson got back. Robinson did the same thing. Pitcher looked over. Finally, the manager came out, and he motioned to the third baseman, stand on the bag, hold Robinson on the base. I never saw that before, haven't seen it since, where third baseman held the runner on the base, and the pitcher kept looking over, threw to the next batter, walked him. Walked in the run, and Robinson walked home and touched the plate and walked back. He created the run all by himself.
Mr. Rickey said that Robinson was the most competitive ball player he had seen since Ty Cobb. But the amazing thing about Robinson was not what he did on the field, but what he did to control himself. For those first 3 years, it was absolutely terrible.
In the coming days, as the Dodgers went around the league, there were threats to shoot Robinson from the stands. Warnings that his wife and infant son would be killed if he dared keep playing. Pitchers threw at his head. Base runners intentionally spiked him. Hotels refused to house him. Bench jockeys began shouting racial slurs during batting practice and kept it up until the last out. Nigger, go back to the cotton fields. Hey, snowflake, which one of the white boys' wives are you dating tonight? Hey, boy, how about a shine?
It was well known that the owners did not want this experiment to work. They wanted Ricky to fail, they wanted Jack to fail, and so whatever they could do behind the scenes, they would do. There were also teams and individuals on teams who did not want it to work.
When Philadelphia came to Ebbets Field, they leveled torrents of abuse led by manager Ben Chapman on Robinson. It was disgraceful. It was terrible. And the Dodger players then became incensed. And Stanky, who had been one of the motivators about that petition down in spring training camp, Stanky then yelled to the Philadelphia dugout, why don't you fellas pick on someone who can answer back? And Mr. Rickey felt that the Philadelphia players' abuse of Robinson was beneficial because it united the white Dodgers for their teammate Robinson.
Oh, and Philadelphia was disgusting. I mean, the way they rode that fellow. Oh. And you know, the Philadelphia press got on Chapman. He was the ringleader. Now it looks like his job is in danger. He has to swallow his pride and ask Robinson if he will have his picture taken with him. And Robinson's mad enough to say, yeah, I will.
The first time the Dodgers showed up in Cincinnati, there was a very hostile crowd. Cincinnati, just across the Ohio River from Kentucky, and Pee-wee is from Louisville, a southerner, a little colonel. And there was a lot of booing going on and set and the other end. And there came a lull in the ball game, and Pee-wee just walked over to where Robinson was standing on the infield and put his arm around his shoulder and talked to him for a moment and then went back, which said to the crowd, this is my friend.
It I would like to bet that no athlete have they ever tried to intimidate more than they did Jackie Robinson. He had tons and tons of guts. But boy, I want to tell you, when they start throwing at you, at your noggin, you get mad, but you better be awful careful about doing it. And he faced that probably as much as any player his first and second year in the big leagues.
The most serious incident came in St. Louis against Branch Rickey's old team, the Cardinals. Enos Country Slaughter, out at first by at least 10 feet, nonetheless jumped into the air and deliberately laid open Robinson's thigh with his spikes. Robinson's anger almost overcame him, but when his teammates threatened to retaliate, he talked them out of it.
I never once heard Jack say out loud, "I want to give up. I don't think I can take it anymore." He would get discouraged, he'd get frustrated, he'd get angry. But by the next morning, you know, he'd kind of sleep it off, and the next day was a new day. I think he felt that, one, he could transcend this provocation because he had a higher goal. I mean, the goal was important to him. The mission was important to him. And he knew that he was holding himself in and constraining himself for a real purpose.
The Sporting News, which had opposed baseball's integration just a few years earlier, now named Robinson its very first Rookie of the Year. In a national poll, he was elected the second most popular man in America after Bing Crosby. Robinson led the league in stolen bases, led the Dodgers in home runs, and had a .297 batting average. More people came to Ebbets Field that summer than at any time in its history. And he had helped drive the Brooklyn Dodgers to the pennant. Other ball player on this club, said Dixie Walker, who had once wanted to quit rather than play alongside a black man, has done more to put the Dodgers up in the race as Robinson has. He is everything Branch Rickey said he was.
I have said that Robinson did more for me than I did for him. I had to change my outlook on racial equations because being raised in the South, when a black ball player came, I had to begin thinking differently. And I had to understand with clear eyes that I should and must accept him equally as I did other players. So to me, it matured me.
The kind of moral suasion that you hope will begin to take place does begin to take place because people start asking questions. Why aren't there more? Where do you get them from? Where's the pool? What happened in the black leagues? You know, all those things begin to be questions. And so the system got questioned and challenged as a result of this.
The most important black person in American history is Martin Luther King. A close second, I would argue, is Jackie Robinson, who came before Martin Luther King and began the consciousness raising of whites and blacks that resulted in Martin Luther King's career. The heroism of Jackie Robinson, playing the game that requires such astonishing concentration and such equipoise, a combination of relaxation and concentration, to play it with his intensity under the pressures he felt on the field from racism, from the stands, off the field, to be the pressure to be, in the awful phrase of the day, a credit to his race, to do all that, all that he did under all that pressure is not just one of the great achievements in the annals of sport, but one of the great achievements of the human drama anywhere, anytime.
Negro baseball ain't dead yet, not by a long shot. It may not be as fat and sassy as it once was, or as robust at the gate, but it is still active, ambulatory.
There was euphoria that another bastion had fallen, but there was worry among the owners of the Negro League teams. They knew from other examples, not just in baseball, that as soon as integration came, the focus in the Negro community would shift from the Negro League teams to, oh, let's just see what Jackie does in the majors. And they knew it was just a matter of time before other Negro Leaguers or just black ball players played for other major league teams. That's exactly what happened, and the Negro League started their inevitable slide downward.
Negro League attendance dwindled away. Black fans wanted to see Jackie Robinson play in the majors. In Chicago, thousands turned out in their Sunday best to watch their hero play. A train, the Jackie Robinson Special, ran all the way from Norfolk, Virginia to Cincinnati, stopping to pick up fans along the way. Overnight, the Dodgers had become Black America's favorite team.
Oh, I rooted for the Brooklyn Dodgers. There's no question about that. Yeah, the Dodgers were Black America's team, period. That I am unequivocally sure about. Yes.
There was a feeling of enormous pride in someone of my color finally doing something that had the nation. Had the nation's ear, you know. Everyone was talking about Jackie Robinson, the first black athlete to play Major League Baseball. And daily, my father would get the newspapers to see exactly what Jackie was doing. And it was a great deal of pride.
Presents Take Me Out to the Ball
Game. Of 1947, the Dodgers faced the Yankees in a hard-fought World Series, the first series in which an African-American had ever played. Some of baseball's most famous stars attended the first game. Babe Ruth, Tris Speaker, even Ty Cobb.
Third inning, Shea again walks
Robinson. And the fleet-footed Dodger may have notions of trying to steal second again. Shea watches him dance off first and tries to pick him off. Look out, Robbie! He's safe. And now Shea accidentally drops the ball in another attempt to throw to first, and it's a balk. Umpire Babe Pinelli waves Robinson on to second.
Robinson played well, but the most memorable moments involved two Italian-Americans. The first was Dodger pinch hitter Cookie Labagetto.
Wait a minute. Sankey is being called back from the plate, and Labagetto goes up to hit. The Yankees are ahead 2-1. Gianfrido, the pinch runners at second, the tying run.
It was game four, bottom of the ninth. The Yankee pitcher was one out away from throwing a no-hitter.
8 2/3 innings, two out last of the ninth. The pitch to Labagetto, swung on and missed. Fastball, it was in there, strike one. Two men out, last of the ninth. The pitch swung on, there's a drive hit out toward the right field corner. Henrik is going back, he can't get it, it's off the wall for a base hit. Here comes the tying run, and here comes the winning run. Friends, they're killing Labagetto, his own teammate. They are beating him to pieces.
Bevins was within one out of a no-hit ball game. So when Labagetto broke up his no-hitter, he scored the two runners and broke up the ball game. And I don't think there's ever been such a sound in Brooklyn as there was that was let loose when that ball hit the right field fence.
In the sixth inning of the sixth game, with the Dodgers leading 8-5, Joe DiMaggio came to bat with two men on. Al Gianfrido, nicknamed the Little Italian, was playing left field.
And the crowd well knows that one swing of this bat, this fellow's capable of making it a brand new game again. Joe leans in. Here's the pitch. Swung on, belted. It's a long one. Deep into left center. Back for Gianfrido. Back, 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 back. He makes a one-handed catch and gets the bullpen. Oh, doctor. He went exactly against the railing in front of the bullpen and reached up with one hand and took a home run away from DiMaggio.
And I'll always remember seeing Gianfrido holding up his black glove with a white spot in the center of it. DiMaggio, thinking it was a home run, was coming into second base, and when he realized the ball had been caught, he stopped and kicked dirt and walked in tight circles out in center field. I think it's one of the few times DiMaggio ever publicly was visibly upset.
Seventh and final game, Yankee Stadium. Page pitching for New York. Ninth inning, Mixes on first, one out. The left-hander takes the stretch, has a look at the runner, throws to Bruce Edwards, who swings. It's a ground ball to Rizzuto. Over to Sternweiss for one out. The relay to first, it's a double play. The Yanks win, and so Page...
In the seventh game, the Yankees beat the Dodgers 5-2 for their 11th World Championship.
If we must get racially conscious about it in determining the laurels of heroism, we'll have to pass the laurels to the players of Italian extraction. In short, it has been a great series, no matter who your parents are. Wendell Smith, Pittsburgh Courier.
In the midst of baseball's most exciting event, the World Series, we pause to honor Jackie Robinson.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. I would just like to say that I was really just a spoke in the wheel of the success that we had some 25 years ago. I would like to also say that I would be a real, real pleasure if Mr. Rickey could have been here with us today, but to the members of the family, my entire love and gratitude for the things that he's done over the years. And I also want to say how pleased I am that my family can be here this afternoon. I'm extremely proud and pleased to be here this afternoon, but must admit I'm going to be tremendously more pleased and more proud when I look at that third base coaching line one day and see a black face managing in baseball. Thank you very much.
25 years after his historic debut, Jackie Robinson agreed to throw out the first ball of the 1972 World Series. He was just 53, but diabetes had dimmed his sight, heart disease had slowed his step, and he was disillusioned by the lack of progress in race relations. Jackie Robinson died 10 days later. In his autobiography published after his death, Robinson recalled playing in his first World Series game. "There I was, the black grandson of a slave, the son of a black sharecropper, part of a historic occasion, a symbolic hero to my people. But I must tell you that it was Mr. Rickey's drama and that I was only a principal actor." As I write this 20 years later and sing the anthem, I cannot salute the flag. I know that I am a black man in a white world. In 1972, in 1947, at my birth in 1919, I know that I never had it made.
I don't know of anybody besides Robinson who could have done what he did. Many of the black players, Reggie Jackson, for example, said later, he's the only one of us who could have done it. Robinson, Mr. Rickey told him he'd have to turn the other cheek. And as Mr. Rickey said, it wasn't long before he didn't have any other cheek to turn. It just had simply been beat off. I think that they said that Robinson died from diabetes and other things. I think he died from the load he carried.
Today we must balance the tears of sorrow with the tears of joy. Mix the bitter with the sweet, death and life. Jackie, as a figure in history, was a rock in the water, creating concentric circles and ripples of new possibilities. He was medicine. He was immunized by God from catching the diseases that he fought. The Lord's arms of protection enabled him to go through dangers seen and unseen, and he had the capacity to wear glory with grace. Jackie's body was a temple of God, an instrument of peace. We would watch him disappear into nothingness and stand back as spectators and watch the suffering from afar. The mercy of God intercepted this process Tuesday and permitted him to steal away home, where referees are out of place and only the supreme judge of the universe speaks.
At the funeral, Jesse Jackson did the eulogy, and he said, "Jackie Robinson stole home and he's safe." And that, even now, is very important to me. Roger Kahn and his family came to visit me a week after Jack died, and they had a blow-up of Jack sliding into home base. And it, when you're looking for simple ways to deal with the grief, the deep, deep grief and mourning that you're feeling, you can catch on to a thing like that. And somehow it is part of baseball, too, that you make the... Giamatti said it best, you make the trip around the bases and somehow you land at home. And home has so many meanings, and so many meanings for people like us who, for whom family and home were the central basis of our operation. I mean, we were family people and people who always had a home, and we always could come home, and you got, it was a retreat from a world that can lay a lot of heavy things on you. So, I carried that blow up from room to room for weeks, just because looking at it, I knew he was safe. Nobody could hurt him again. He wouldn't hear the name calling. He would only hear the cheers. And somehow I could fantasize my own little story about where he was and how he was doing and let him rest in peace.
He was buried a few miles from Ebbets Field.